Afternoon to everybody. Last class, we generally talked about the mining and milling of uranium ore. Specifically, for the mine, Jadugudha mine, and its associated, I think, six mines in Chhattisgarh and the mine in Tumalapalli and three mills at Jadugudha, Thudamdi and Tumalapalli. So we have seen this mines and mills, they are extracting uranium from the ore and then making the yellow cake. This yellow cake is being utilized for production of nuclear grade fuel. Today we will be talking about production of nuclear grade uranium metal and the fuel fabrication. So these are few lines which we said in the first, during our first meeting on the first class, initiation of this activity in India. I only have given these lines and the names only to keep you in your mind, these names, because they were the starters of this activity. So uranium metal, as you know, this is symbol is uranium, atomic number 92 and atomic weight 238.03. Density is 18,900 kg per meter cube, if you say it in that unit, and its melting point is 1132 degree centigrade. So it is very dense. When you take this 1 ton or half a ton metal ingot, that will be so compact. Just by looking at this, you won't be able to really assume that this is weighing that much. So it makes the ore very compact. But its bad point is this melting point. It is quite low compared to uranium oxide. That's the reason why uranium metal cannot be used for high temperature reactors. Generally, it is fuel for the research reactors. Element was discovered by Clapperton 1789, long back before our nuclear this activity started, and major use of this, as you all know, was for ceramic industries, because uranium chemistry is very colorful chemistry. If you see the uranium salts, beautiful colors. This first one is, as you are listening everywhere, that yellow cake, yellow one. Then you have black uranium oxide. Then you have your green uranium tetrafluoride, brown uranium dioxide. So there are various colors which makes the uranium chemistry very colorful. And this element was first isolated as a metallic form by Seligot in 1841, when our nuclear activity started. So this shows you that beautiful plant. I told you at the beginning that inside BRC, the first activity was the thorium plant. So this background is thorium plant, and behind that is your sea and mountains. And this one was the first plant, uranium metal plant, which was started in 1956 and 59. We had our first ingot, and in this corner somewhere was Apsara. So now everything has been changed. New plants have come. Locations are more or less similar, but plants have changed. So new buildings have come. This is your flow sheet for general production of uranium metal ingot. In this flow sheet, there are many alternatives, but this is a commercial flow sheet at this moment, when we can see that whatever material is coming as diuranate from the mills, as we have seen in the last class, that they are not pure enough to take directly for reactors. So they need further purification before making the fuel. And now, actually, from diuranate, we have shifted to uranium oxide. This uranium oxide is peroxide. So this peroxide is, from the purity point of view, it is better than diuranate cake. So this has given a lot of advantage to the front end persons, those who are using this material. But still, it needs purification before starting the fuel material. So for purification, as we discussed, that mostly we go for solvent extraction, and tributyl phosphate is the solvent used for this purification. So tributyl phosphate works in nitrate medium. We dissolve in nitric acid this material, and after that we do with 32% TVP in kerosene, that is the solvent. In solvent extraction, we have three steps. First is the solvent extraction, where we extract the uranium preferentially, leaving all the impurities in the raffinate. And this uranium preferentially goes to the solvent phase, that is the organic phase. Then it is scrubbed to remove all carried over impurities. And then from there, it is taken for stripping. Stripping is done with demineralized water. So we get pure uranyl nitrate solution in demineralized water. This is a reactor grade pure. And raffinate contains all the impurities along with acid. Because here for solvent extraction, we need a particular amount of acidity. Otherwise, solvent extraction is not fully utilized. So for this particular our efficiency of the extraction method, we need to have a particular free acidity for this feed. So this acid remains here. So long SDU cakes or the diuranate cakes were impure, it was being neutralized and effluents were disposed after proper treatment. But now, as it is improved with this peroxide cake, so this also people are trying to utilize, reuse for dissolution. So after this, we take this pure uranyl nitrate solution, and there are various methods to get oxide from this. So one which was quite used, that was direct denitration of the uranyl nitrate solution by heating. But for the Indian reactors and many others, ammonium diuranate precipitation route is being followed for obtaining the oxide with the particular morphology for further reactions for the metal grade. So for this, pure uranyl nitrate is treated with ammonia gas. Precipitation can be done with liquid ammonia also. But here in this case, for this attaining the particular morphology and the size distributions, our gaseous ammonia has been selected, and air is being utilized for dilution of the ammonia at the reaction point. This is a very important step to get a proper quality powder, because this morphology will be carried over for all other compounds down the line. So once ammonium diuranate has been precipitated, it is all these steps we'll talk in little details afterwards. It will be filtered, and this filtered also for some reuse it is being used, and the cake is our actual uranium cake. So this will be calcined to get uranium trioxide, and if we get some pure material from the mill, that can directly join here, so that we can directly calcine here. No need to go for this purification steps. So it will be uranium trioxide which we get after calcination of Edu cake. This uranium trioxide will be reduced next, reduced with cracked ammonia. So it gives EO2. EO2 is generally pyrophoric in nature. So if it has to be taken for further operations, we don't open the bunkers or the reactors. We directly take it for further operations. But if it has to be taken for uranium oxide fuel production, then it has to be stabilized. We will come to these steps during fuel fabrication. So when it is to be done as a EO2 fuel, then it will be taken out for stabilization. Otherwise, it will go further for hydrofluorination. Hydrofluorination is being done with anhydrous hydrofluoric acid to get EF4. This EF4, I told you that it's pretty nice green, parrot green color. And this reaction is also very important for completion of the conversion, as this EF4 assay is very important for metallothermic reduction. Metallothermic reduction is being done for getting uranium metal. So EF4 will be reduced with magnesium chips. We'll see those things in details further. So during this reaction, we'll get magnesium fluoride slag, which will be taken out and have uranium metal ingot. So this ingot is taken for reactor fuel fabrication. Now, other recycling or waste, whatever waste will be there, everything will go to the central waste management, and after proper processing only, they will be disposed following the proper norms. And the things which will be recycling the plant, they will be taken inside the plant, like magnesium fluoride partly recycled, acids partly recycled, then HF scrubbing solutions fully recycled only after some regeneration. So this is the way maximum utilization of the waste material is also being done, and minimum whatever will go for disposal, that will be sending through proper disposal unit. This is one more flow sheet. This gives you the powder production. Metal can be in the form of metal ingots that we call as a massive metal, or it can be in the powder form. For some reactors, they need this metal in powder form. So for powder form, here this flow sheet has been given for the enriched. When we EF6 means it will be enriched. So when they wanted to get that enriched powder for some particular reactors, they will be doing this hydrolysis of EF6 gas. And after hydrolysis of EF6 gas, the hydrolyzed solution will be treated with ammonium hydroxide to get ammonium diuronate cake. Ammonium diuronate cake will be pyrohydrolyzed to get uranium trioxide, and this cracked ammonia gas will be used again to reduce uranium trioxide to give you uranium dioxide. And in case of powder production, uranium dioxide directly is reduced. And these are small scale operations, so calcium granules are used for because here the thermodynamic feasibility is much better. So this is done with this calciothermy reduction, and you get the after reduction you get uranium granules distributed in the slag material, that is calcium oxide slag. So for separation of this material, in case of metal ingots, this separation is done by physical separation, but in case of powders, this separation has to be done with chemical operations, that is leaching. And after leaching, this uranium granules will be taken out from slag, and they will be vacuum dried, packed under argon atmosphere, and used for further activities. So this is for the detailing of the refining. As we said, that it is containing natural uranium contains only 0.712% U-235. So you need very high grade of purity, and most of the impurities which are neutron eaters are gadolinium, boron, cadmium. So they will be removed by the solvent extraction. And if we see the specification of your uranium metal, you will see that very high grade purity is needed. So specific to your all neutronators like Gd, europium, 0.04 ppm. So at that, to maintain this purity level, it is very difficult, but solvent extraction is a really good way of doing this. So every step for all the materials, you have to see this specification, whether it is meeting or not, and then you can go ahead for the further steps. So as we have seen, for the metal production, this uranium metal is required for fueling the research reactor. As I said, it doesn't go for high temperature reactors. Then uranium dioxide in between, whatever we get, that we can take as a ceramic fuel for PHWS, PWS and BWS. Only light water reactor fuels will be enriched. PHWS will be natural. And in between, after EFO, you have to take the stream out if you have to do the enrichment, because we have to make it to uranium hexafluoride. So here we have seen that after purification, when you get the nuclear pure uranyl nitrate solution, this is the feed material for all of you. And this morphology part, actually already a lot of we have done our publications. So when in the last class I give you all the reference books and the acknowledgement parts, so there we will mention all additional reading materials where you can get additional information about morphology, because that is a very important requirement for conversion, complete conversion. So this is EDU reactor. As I said, that EDU precipitate actually controls the whole process. So here it is a continuously start and reactor, completely closed one. Inside you will be having uranyl nitrate solution of particular concentration of uranyl nitrate, and acidity also will be controlled, and the rate of ammonia addition, air addition, agitation, everything plays very important role to get the proper quality EDU material. These are the rotary reactors, what is being used for calcination and reduction of this ADC to uranium dioxide. So we, this is also fully closed unit. In the one bunker will be having our feed material, and at the receiving end, another bunker closed will contain the reactor product. As EO2, we don't want it to give any exposure. It will be totally closed. And counter current reducing gas, that is the cracked ammonia, at around 500 to 600 temperature, it will be passed and we'll get uranium dioxide. So when uranium dioxide we have to take as a fuel, these bunkers will go in similar another furnace where we will do stabilization of uranium dioxide. Stabilization means it is a very partial reoxidation to make it UO2 plus XX is a very small quantity, but this is just to stop its pyrophorosity so that it can be handled further. And for metal, we have to go this UO2 in the pyrophoric form only for hydrofluorination. So hydrofluorination is also done in a similar rotary tubular horizontal furnaces. Here, also similar way, feeding material and receiving material. And we have HF gas, which will be flowing, HF vapor, which will be flowing counter current way. And EO2 will get converted to EO4. This EO4 will be collected in the bunkers and taken for further activities. And when we have to do a enrichment, then the CO4 bunkers will be taken for further fluorination with fluorine gas to UF6 and further down the line operation for enrichment and all. And when it will be going for the metal production, it will be taken to metallothermic reduction. So this metallothermic reduction is practiced for production of metal ingots. This can be natural uranium or depleted uranium. This can be enriched uranium also, but only in case of enriched uranium, you have to take care of the sizing and the weight of the material because of nuclear criticality problem. For natural depleted uranium, we don't have that problem. And metal powders also, as you have seen, by metallothermic reduction. Metal production in massive form. While uranium metal can be produced in a number of ways, the practiced one, which we see in large scale production, is mostly the reduction of uranium halides, specifically UF4, with either calcium or magnesium. So the massive form uranium ingot during this reduction can be formed only if heat of reaction melts the uranium and the slag in the state of adequate fluidity. Means inside the reactor, means here we are, whatever reactor I will use here, all are for the chemical reactors. This metallothermic reduction reactor, when the reaction will occur, then the charge, whole charge, has to be in molten form. Magnesium slag, magnesium fluoride slag, and uranium, both. And they have to be in that molten condition for quite some time, till the separation occurs. The separation is a natural way, natural process, because inside the reactor it happens because of very high density difference. Magnesium fluoride is lighter. After the reaction, if it is in the molten condition, it will come up. and uranium will go down. And at the bottom of this magnetothermic reduction reactor, we keep graphite crucible. So this molten uranium goes there and gets settled in that graphite crucible. So if the heat is sufficient for keeping this two in a molten condition for a required time for this separation, because molten uranium is very viscous, so it needs little time for the separation, and there is no other additional aid provided, because whatever you put, uranium will get contaminated again. So you have to keep it in a, maintain the condition in such a way that after reaction they remain in a molten condition for sufficient amount of time and get separated to get a good black metal separation. And this reactor is generally a boiler quality mild scale where the reaction occurs, and it is lined with magnesium fluoride, the slag material which is being generated during the process. This is being recycled to make the lining for the reactor. So we will just see this reaction. This is an exothermic reaction. However, it is less exothermic than calcium. Calcium heat of reaction is nearly double, 134. So this calcium, when calcium was used, this heat of reaction was sufficient to keep the full charge in the molten condition without any additional heat from the outside. But in case of magnesium, as the heat of reaction is not so high, it needs some additional heat boosting. So at the initial period, we heat the whole charge to around 700 degrees centigrade, and then at a particular point the reaction starts. This reaction is instantaneous reaction. Within few seconds the reaction gets over, and by that time from the outside heat, whatever you have put into them before reaction and during reaction, whatever is going on, so whatever we got, with that they become in the fluid state and the separation occurs. And low boiling point of magnesium demands closed reactor, means you have to keep the reactor closed during firing. Advantages of magnetothermy over calciothermy is better purity of the reaction product. Actually, calcium is very reactive, as you know, so its handling is very difficult and get very readily reactive with other materials, so it gets contaminated sometimes. So compared to that, magnesium purity maintenance is better, and cost of magnesium is lower than calcium. Reductant quantity required per unit weight of uranium metal production is lower for magnesium, because you see this is about the molecular weight, and at the heat of reaction is not that high, so control is better for the large scale production. Based on above advantages, magnetothermy is practiced for large scale production of massive ingots. In this you can see that this is the pit type reactor, what actually during our zirconium also you have seen that it is used, similar pit type furnaces are used here also. So this is the reactor which will be initially lined with magnesium fluoride, then it will be filled up with that green colored UF4 and magnesium chips mixture, and then it will be, lid will be closed. This is the flange with that lid will be there, and they will be put in the furnace for certain period of time. These are all pre-scheduled, Once the reaction occurs, we get the indication from the increase in the temperature from the core of the reactor, and based on that, it has been kept for cooling. And after cooling, sufficient cooling, when they solidified, if you open the reactor, you will see this condition. Inside is your uranium, and outside is your slag material. And once it is discharged, you will see the top slag. It is at the top, and the bottom, your uranium ingot is separated, which will be inside a graphite crucible. So from there, this ingot is taken for cleaning, and then it will be sent for fuel production. After definitely the analysis and all quality check. And for the powder, you see that this is small scale operations with calcium oxide. Calcium. Here it is, oxide is getting reduced. So calcium reacts both with U3O8 and UO3, but more exothermical with UO2. So more exothermicity is with UO2. The UO3 more exothermic than UO2. So UO2 is a choice as most suitable oxide due to per unit weight of uranium production. Quantity of reducing agent required is less for UO2. It's again that stoichiometry you can see, and the reduction reaction control is easier with UO2 as the heat of reaction is lower than UO3. So here, why we get the powder? Because during the reaction, slag does not get melted. It's only uranium which is produced during the reaction. It is in the molten condition and forms the primary globules. So it is dispersed in the whole slag, and then this from the slag, you will get uranium by leaching the whole mass. These are all documented nicely and published. So I'll give you that literature details. Whoever is interested can go through more. They'll know better. Next is that we said monazite is also another source of uranium. So one step on that. This monazite sand we get by physical separations, like there are a few steps in that. Beach sands being treated with different physical separation processes like magnetic separation, then gravity separation. First is gravity separation, then magnetic separation, then it takes conductivity based separations, and after that you get four fractions. One of them is monazite, another one is zircon, which goes for zirconium production, and monazite is for thorium. So Indian monazite contains around 0.38% U3O8. The chemical composition of monazite sand is thoria 10%, thoria 27.5%, and you can see that rare earth is the major part, around 60%. So major, we can see major components are this rare earth, thorium. If we wanted to take out the uranium, so we have to take them out. So generally, this monazite sand, which is a phosphatic material, it's dissolved in thorium hydroxide to get phosphatic material as trisodium phosphate, which is filtered, and the filtrate is trisodium phosphate, which is taken for further use, and the cake is rich in rare earth, uranium, thorium, which is dissolved in HCl. There are many processes, this is one of them. So After that, the pH is adjusted to around 3, where selective leaching of rare earths takes place, and thorium uranium cake gets separated. This is again dissolved in HCl. From there, by amine extraction, you can take out uranium, and remaining solution can be taken for thorium production or thorium utilization. And this, after amine extraction, HU precipitation can be done, and then it can go to the main route. So here just shown the thorium also can be done in this calciothermic reduction. Thorium powders also can be produced, and from this thorium powder, thorium buttons also have been produced. This is also a good developmental activities which has been already published, and you can go through the literature to see the further. Now we come to the fuel fabrication, fuel production. We have seen that we got the fuel materials, which is your either uranium oxide or uranium metal powder or uranium metal ingot. Now, during our first class, we said that fuel is that particular assembly where fissile material is encapsulated in a non-fissile cover, which we call the fuel pin or fuel enclosure, and that is bundled in the assembly, and assembly is used as the fuel in the core of the reactor. Now, this fuel can be classified in many ways. Like if you have your reactor based operation classifications, like fuel for research reactors, fuel for PHWRs, fuel for LWRs. So based on reactor type, your fuels you can classify. Then you can classify your fuels based on your clad material. Sometimes the clad materials may be fully ceramic, like your chrysocoated particles, where the cladding is totally ceramic material, silicon carbide, pyrocarbon layers. And for first reactors, the clad will be your stainless steel. For PHWRs, clad is zirconium. There may be different shapes also. Sometimes it will be plate tight, the whole fuel. Sometimes it will be pin tight. Sometimes it will rod. So based on that also, some classifications may be there. But here we mostly divide them in broadly two categories here. The basic characterization way is ceramic and metallic fuel. So ceramic fuel is definitely with the material, fissile material, which is suitable for high temperature. So these are mostly oxide type, uranium oxide, plutonium oxide, or carbide or nitrides. And metallic fuels is fuels are uranium metal, plutonium metal, or thorium metal, if that is designed. And as we have already seen during our discussions, that for design of a fuel element, we have to ensure few things. The first important one, that proper nuclear properties has to be there. which will ensure the neutron economy of the reactor core for sustained and extractable power generation. And second is that it has to have this mechanical strength to withstand the severe environment inside the reactor. These environments are severe due to what? High temperature gradient, then diverse mechanical stresses, and unavoidable change in the composition due to the fissile reactions. And the third requirement is that it has to be corrosion resistant from with the coolant also, and inside your its own fission product. So clad plays an important role in this. It protects most of the size shape of this fuel material, and also helps in corrosion resistance. And as we said, that clad material has to have this good neutron economy. That's the reason why we use the specific type of materials only for the clad, along with the chemical stability. So now, based on all these points, we can have many different types of fuels, but for our particular use, we will be discussing for this three major type of fuel productions. One is that uranium dioxide ceramic fuel fabrication, which are the major types of fuel we are for PHWR, BWR, and PWR. All three cases we use mostly uranium dioxide. Only the fissile material composition changes. MOX fuels for this FNRs. MOX, that is plutonium oxide, uranium oxide. MOX can be of other types also, thoria, uranium, thoria, plutonium also. And metal fuel, which is for the research reactors, as we have discussed. In this dioxide ceramic fuel fabrication, the steps involved are, first is stabilization. As I said, that we have to have stabilized powder for handling outside. After that, we have to do a pre-compaction and granulation. Pre-compaction of this powder is needed to form pellets of lower density, which will be granulated. This process is being done only to improve the flowability and the filling factors during final compaction, flowability of the material and the density for final compaction. Then it will be blended with binder materials, and after that it will go for final compaction. In this final compaction, the pellets are compacted in hydraulic presses, multi-cavity hydraulic presses, around 3 ton pressure. With that, we aim to get around 50%, 50 to 55% of the theoretical density of EO2. EO2 theoretical density is 50% we achieve here in this pellet. So this green pellet will be sintered at high temperature, around 1700 degrees centigrade, in presence of reducing gas like cracked ammonia. And after centering, they attain nearly more than 90% of the critical density. And these pellets, after inspection, standard procedure, they will be taken into the zirconium pins, stacked in the zirconium pins, and after enclosures with proper tips, rail assembly will be prepared. For this 500 megawatt units, we have 39 pin fuel bundle assembled in 3 rows. That fuel pin is approximate diameter is around 13 millimeter with a length of 485 millimeter. Inside that pellets will be there, and there will be fuel plenum for these gases, fission gases, to take care. So with this, it covers the ceramic fuel for it. Now we see for MOX fuel. MOX fuel also procedure is similar. Only thing, at the beginning we have to do a good homogenization of the mixed oxide depending on the proportions or the ratios required, because there is density difference. So based on all, we have to make a mixing planning, and then you can go ahead as per this first reconstruction granulation, then final compaction, centering. Here also centering is around 1650 degree centigrade zone. Pellet degassing, stack making, loading, assembly. Here your fuel pin material is SS. Top end plug welding, decontamination, packing, and delivery. So these are meant for FNRs, but some MOX was used for our research reactors. Some were used for BWS also. Last one is our metal fuel fabrication. This metal fuel fabrication, we have little different step here. The major steps are actually induction melting and casting of the billet. Portable metal ingots are produced. They will be vacuum induction melted and then casted in through bottom pouring in the graphite crucibles. After that, to take to a proper shape, it will be done in run by extrusion. So basically, induction melting or any sort of melting casting and plastic deformation. So these two are the major steps for all metallic fuels. Here it is extrusion. From here it may be rolling. So this, after extrusion, you have to do a heat treatment. Actually, metallic fuels and ceramic fuels, if we just do a comparison, I think you all have already learned it during your reactor classes. This metallic fuels are having a very good properties, like they are good thermal conductivity, and in the specific amount, the amount of fissile material is, concentration is more because it is not diluted by oxygen. So these two are very good qualities, but they have the problems like low melting point. Then there is phase transformation. Uranium is having three, means it goes from alpha to beta, beta to gamma. Because of that, there is a lot of change in there. Mechanical and physical properties. So, and on the top of it, the slow melting point. So it becomes difficult for using it in the high temperature reactor. This here also, this heat treatment is also a product of that. Means during your extrusion, these grains are oriented in a particular direction. Now, this for giving a better heat condition in their metallurgical properties, so that their dimensional stability can be maintained. So we give a heat treatment. Otherwise, they have anisotropy in their character, which makes them different direction, different one side contraction, one side expansion. So fuel gets deformed during heating. So to minimize that, this particular heat treatment, beta heat treatment, is required. Now after that, you have to go for buttoning, threading. That is a mechanical requirement. Degreasing and other cleaning arrangements. This is with aluminium clad. So this cladding is done in a draw bench to have a good mechanical fitting with the metal uranium, so that your heat transfer resistance is minimum. Then after that, after cutting the additional cladding material, we have to enclose, peak welding, cluster assembly, cluster welding, cluster straightening, packing, and delivery. So with this few steps, we complete our fuel fabrication part. And we end with this. Next class, we'll be seeing the back end. And we'll be also getting the reference material and all acknowledgement parts, so that you can go for further studies. One more point which I forgot to tell you, that basic differences, we just said about the metallic fuels, what are the points, but for the disadvantage of ceramic fuels also, you must keep in mind that because of this poor thermal conductivity, so heat transfer is not that good as of metallic fuels, and also dilution of your fissile material in the oxide matrix. Thank you.